Oh, Janet, Mary Eileen is here.
Oh my gosh.
Hi folks. We got a lot of people coming in now as I finally let you in. You were all waiting so patiently. Thank you for that. I'm just gonna give people one more minute to kind of get settled in, and then we will get started. I am recording this just so everybody is aware. For folks who couldn't be here live tonight, or if you do have to leave before it's over, there will be a recording that you can access later to see what you missed. It's all going to be very exciting. So, all right. Well, welcome to Tea and Tapas, teamwork and story building, storytelling through art science. Really excited to have you all here. I'm here as a learner mostly myself. We have two special guests who I'll be introducing in just a minute. My name is Nicole Filizetti. I'm with the LEAF program. You won't hear much from me tonight, though. Really, tonight is about hearing from the folks that came to join us, Janet and Mary. Before we get into that, I want to tell you a little bit about the tea that I made. The focus of this whole series is about seasonal foods, seasonal teas, and making some connections to the outdoors through those sorts of things. So I made myself a dandelion root tea latte tonight. I used a strong dandelion tea, and then I sweetened it with a little maple syrup and added some steamed milk. It's really yummy. If you've never had dandelion tea, it's a little bitter. Traditionally, folks use it to support digestive health and you know, liver support and things like that. So you can mix it with your coffee or drink it straight. You can sweeten it like I did, or have it with other bitter herbs like chicory is another good one that mixes with dandelion. So that's what I'm drinking tonight. Feel free to get up and make yourself a cup of tea or coffee if it's that kind of time of day for you. We're going to be a little bit casual tonight, so feel free to get up and get something to drink if you want. I didn't make any snacks, but my colleague Kate did make a little seasonal tapas, and she's going to tell us about that before we get started.
All right. So I didn't do anything too extensive, but I have a smoothie here. And it's mostly a berry smoothie, but dandelion greens have lots of nutrients, and it's super exciting because it's like, whoa, we just went through a long winter and these are the first little greens popping up. And so you can just find dandelions, let me find my camera, anywhere. And this is the root that Nicole was talking about, that you can use in tea. And then you can also use the leaves. So pretty much the whole plant. There's a lot of other greens that are popping up right now that are also good to use. In my yard, I have mostly dandelions as the weed that we don't like, but look at me use this dandelion weed. And so, yeah, if you want to just throw extra greens into smoothies or salads or whatever, that's a great way to incorporate some of those little extra greens coming up in the spring season. So.
Thanks. Kate has dandelions coming up in her yard, and I actually have snow coming down right now, unfortunately, but I'll have dandelions soon enough. So logistics, feel free to keep your camera on or turn it off, whatever works better for you. We will have a couple of breaks to do question and answer. And so you can put your questions in the chat as you're thinking about them. And then we will stop midway through to get to some of those questions, and then take some time again at the end to get to some questions. But if anything is really, really burning and you want to unmute yourself and ask it out loud, you can do that as well. So it's going to be a casual hour here. And let's jump right in then. I will tell you very briefly about Janet and Mary, and mostly they will tell you about themselves through showing you their work. Janet Moore is an artist, an educator who's living up on Madeline Island, lucky her. And she's been associated with the WCE for quite a few years now. Mary Lau is a art teacher at Midvale Elementary in Madison, and has also been associated with the WCE for a while. So we're really excited to have them. They're going to give you their perspective on the how art and science come together to really support each other, and just some really unique projects that they've worked on to help their students connect with the world around them and connect to the time and place. And I'm really excited to learn from them. So welcome, Janet and Mary. I'm gonna mute myself, but if you need me to share anything from my screen, just let me know.
All right. Thank you, Nicole. What a great introduction. And I have just
to talk about the link between art and science. I have always been really intrigued with that because we almost seem to have a stereotype in our culture that you're either this left-brained person or you're this really artistic person and the two shall not meet. But one of the things that I did in my research, because I have a master's in environmental ed from Stevens Point, was to see how art could almost be used as a tool for learning. This was more specifically in science, but to, you know, kind of help us develop observation skills using a different sensory channel than written language, you know, verbal language. So that was my research area. Really quickly, what I did was I worked with middle school kids to actually use drawing as a tool in a tree ID exercise. And the big takeaway message in that is you could really see kids, and I have seen adults who have a hard time maybe focusing or looking at details, really responding to this this tool of drawing, this process of drawing as a way to slow down and look more closely. Because if you're looking at something like, say, this, you know, pussy willow branch, and you're just walking by it in the yard, you might see it. You think, ah, there's some pussy willows. But if you have to actually sit down and draw all the different little parts of it, it kind of triggers and helps you retain the memory of that. So that's what I found. So that's kind of the long and short of what I've been intrigued with and what I've been doing. So I've used that theory in a lot of ways through the years to use drawing and use art as a way to connect better with the world around us. So I live on Madeline Island, watercolor artist, botanical artist. I did a winter tree ID guide, so using winter twigs, and maybe we can bring that up, because I wanted to illustrate, we think of art sometimes as this creative process, which it is, but it's also a very informative process. And, you know, scientific illustration is a little bit different than artistic expression, and it's meant to be very accurate. So I don't know if you pulled that up at all, Nicole, and we can just show a quick example on a screen share.
Yeah, so I'm going to put the resource list in the chat so folks have it, and then I will pull up the winter trip twig key for everybody to see.
Yeah, great. And I think it would be great, while you're pulling that up, Nicole, we put out a email or some kind of message to you guys about having a twig or something that you would want to draw, and guiding you through kind of how, you know, we can approach this drawing thing. Because how many people on here like identify as artists? Say, you do, right? How many people on here would say, oh God, I can't draw, I'm scared. I can't see everybody in my... Quite a few. And that's what I get from people who are non-artists a lot of times. And, you know, if you take away the idea that you have to draw something expressive and something wonderful and look at it as just a way to record information, that's a way to kind of step back from that intimidation. And I've seen that with a lot of people. So one of the things that I like to do in drawing is to just take a specimen. And if you've got a twig, I'm going to do a crazy little online demo here. I picked a pussy willow from out my yard. Yes, something is actually growing in the north on Madeline Island. I'm going to swing this way because then we have a little bit better background. But you don't need anything other than a piece of paper. Any piece of paper you have around is great. Pencil. I like to have a little sharpener. Erasers are good. But one of the shortcuts that I like to take with this is a ruler, your usual like $1 wood ruler from Walmart. But one of the shortcuts I like to teach people that makes it easier is actually take your ruler and measure how long your twig is that you want it to be. So this is kind of weird because I'm holding it up, but I can see that's about 3.5 inches that I'm going to work with. So I even take my ruler and I put it down on my page. And instead of just blindly going in that space, and this works great for kids, I actually make a little dot at the beginning and the end. So there are my dots. And I might do this in pen, actually, because that's going to show up better for you. And we could do a, you know, maybe just a little 5-minute exercise in drawing, doing just a line drawing, right? And what I generally do is I start at the beginning of my object. And you try to imagine, and I have a video that illustrates this too, but you try to imagine your pencil or your writing instrument actually following the edge of the object. So your eye is following the edge of the object. And what you're trying to do is you're trying to get your hand to move along with where your eye is going. And it takes some practice, but just about everybody that I have ever met can come out of really observing what they're drawing and come up with something that's recognizable that you could pass to somebody else and they could say, oh yeah, that's a pussy willow. Or that's, I have an example about an acorn. So are you guys good for going through and trying this?
Yeah, Janet, if they weren't able to grab a twig, do you just want them to take another item from their house?
Any old thing that's laying around. I mean, my cat's back there, but I don't think she's going to hold still. So I'm going to just deal with a twig. But just start to look at things. And Nicole, if you can kind of be the timekeeper, we could do this for about 5 minutes.
Okay, I'll be the 5-minute timekeeper.
And try to just look at every shape that you're coming across and draw it. I'm even doing this backwards, which is, and if you do this often enough, you will notice that you generally will find something new about the object that you're drawing.
Janet, some folks are wondering if I can make you bigger on the screen. Do you mind if I stop sharing?
Yeah, make me bigger. Go ahead.
Okay. All right.
And you can always look at that winter tree ID resource. That was just mainly to show you that, yes, I am a competent artist before I start. But I did that years ago, and it really was kind of cool to draw the twigs to have them fit in with the description. So people have found that useful. So I'm just drawing this, you know, sweet pussy willow as it goes along. And if you really want to get good at drawing, it's like anything else. If you take up a sport, you don't just, you know, I tell kids, do you just go to soccer practice 1 or 2 times and you know how to kick or you know how to do what you need to do? No, you go to practice every day. If you're learning an instrument, you practice every day. And a good rule of thumb is to sit down for maybe 15 minutes a day and just do a drawing of anything that you have around. Oh, I can see that my pussy willow here is starting to sprout some leaves. Okay, I pretty much have what I wanted to do with that. And so you're just looking at, again, kind of having your pen follow the edge of what you're drawing. And if you think of it that way versus, you know, taking in the whole thing, just doing it kind of shape by shape and following the edge, I think you make a lot better progress. Does that make sense to people? All right. We can move on when people kind of feel like it, Nicole. I don't want to take too much time, but I want to give people a little bit to absorb sure. it.
How about everybody takes another minute or so just to kind of wrap up your progress on your practice, and then Janet will move on.
You never run out of sticks and objects to draw. You could always just go for rocks if, you know.
Well, we're kind of waiting here too. I just want to say, I really appreciate the idea of like, yeah, just do it for like 15 minutes a day. And those stereotypes that we do have where it's like, oh, I'm a horrible artist. And art is more about the creative process and the inquiry than it is about creating this object that is perfect. And so thanks for emphasizing that and really being like, everyone can do it. And if you practice, you get better.
Yeah, there's that. And then there's the other end of the spectrum where, you know, you'll have kids and people who will want to know how to draw something realistically or have something look like they imagine it in their mind. And we just tell them, do you find this, Mary, the blanket statement? Oh, whatever you do in art is great. You're just, you know, expressive. And we're not like helping them develop the skills that, you know, they may feel frustrated with and saying, oh, you know, your problem is, you know, you're drawing this maybe a little bit longer than it truly is. Go back and, you know, look at it. So, you know, that's something I do with observational drawing is you kind of build confidence. You're more the bona fide art educator, Mary. So feel free to.
No, I really subscribe to that. I always tell the students, draw to communicate. Draw what you see is different than drawing what you know.
Right.
So, because that's observational drawing, it works so well to use that word, you know, supplant it later and say, hey, draw really what you're observing. And I think it's just those little gradual steps of drawing. It's really just enjoyable. It's not like painful.
Right. It shouldn't be.
No.
And that's where, you know, simple little tools like rulers and things like that are great to work with kids and say, look, is that actually 2 inches long? Actually go down there and measure it. You know, so drawing things from life size is great. All right. You know, it's so hard with this. If you're in front of a class of like real breathing people, I can see when people are done. I can see when people are just, you know, wanting to move on. And it's hard to do that in a virtual mode, so.
Well, I think folks who want to keep sketching while you talk can yeah. continue to do that.
So. You can do that as much as you want. Yeah. Let's move on, Nicole. And I could share a couple of videos that I've done this fall out here on Madeline Island. We have 12 kids in our elementary school. I mean, that's it. And they were virtual most of the time. And so when we were virtual, I actually developed a few videos and some online lessons that could be put in their Canvas modules that they could do independently on their own as, you know, part of kind of an art science project. So yes, I went out and had somebody take my iPhone and did a couple videos, and I guess they're not too bad, but they might be that. And I wrote up, they're not exactly formal lesson plans. You may want to formalize them more if you use them, but a write-up for the teachers to put in their Canvas modules that parents also would be able to take a look at and, you know, engage with them on. So can we share video one?
Sure, which is the drawing and discovery?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it's kind of like a crazy, not even really Bob Ross, but Janet in the woods.
Hey kids, Janet here. I'm up here on the north end of the island on one of my favorite trails to walk on. And I know you're doing some hikes and walks in the woods. And I'm going to introduce our drawing activity through walking through the woods and finding a really cool object to draw. So follow me while I walk along my trail.
I'm just going to pause it for a second to turn my volume up. Apologies.
Sounds good.
I'm seeing a lot of really cool things. that I could work with, that I could draw. There's some really nice fall leaves. I'm seeing some sticks, some mushrooms. Oh my,
this is pretty cool.
It's an acorn. Acorns make really great things to draw. So I'm going to pick that up and take this with me. You might want to think about when you pick up your object, make sure it's something small that you can bring along. You can take it home with you, but I think this spot right up here is a really good spot to sit and draw for a little bit. All right, so I always have my sketchbook with me, and I've got my pencil in here, and I've got my eraser in case I make a mistake and want to erase it. And I can just sit down in this nice little spot, spend some time with this little object that I chose. So when you're choosing something, don't overthink it. Just pick something kind of small and simple and watch really closely as you draw. So the object is to find out something new about this thing that you picked up through drawing it. This little guy I can just hold right in my hand. And as I draw, what I'm trying to do is imagine my pencil going along the edge of that object. So I'm going to start right over here. And I can just follow the edge. And you might either draw it the same size that it really is in real life, or you can make it a little bigger. I'm making it a little bigger so you can see. So that's that general shape, right? It's got a little point at the end. And then this little cap on the top, it's kind of an oval, isn't it? Let's just draw that. Following the edge with my eye and then my hand. Just imagining my pencil tracing right along the edge of that object. Boy, I never knew acorns had so many little curves and dents. So now I'm getting to the stem, and boy, that stem isn't something that sticks straight up. Kind of has a little bend to it where it used to be attached to the tree. Then it fell to the ground. Okay, and now I'm looking here, I can see it has a little crack in it. And there's actually a lichen growing in that crack. I'm gonna draw that. And there's all these little things called scales that make this interesting texture on the cap. Don't worry about shading and all that. Just use your pencil and make lines to show the different textures. That would take a while to fill in all those scales, but I think you get the idea. The other thing I see on here are there little lines. They're real tiny, they're hard to see. But they go all the way down the acorn and they're curved and they kind of show the shape of it. So there you have it. That's kind of your basic acorn drawing. Now, when you go out, you're probably going to find something different. You might find a nice rock or a leaf or anything, but the object of drawing is to find out something new, to discover something new by sitting and spending some time with your object, observing it, looking at it very closely, and capturing that detail just with your pencil. All right, so I really look forward to seeing the drawings that you come up with, and I really look forward to you guys telling me something new that you discovered by doing a drawing.
Yeah, so that was that. There's another one that I did where we were drawing a tree. I don't think we need to, you know, go into showing that because it's basically the same process, you know, of the observation. But one thing I guess I'd really like to emphasize, and I think Mary will give a really good example of this, is how you can you don't have to be living on the north end of Madeline Island in wild, pristine nature to find something worthy of drawing and doing. I mean, this is something you can find, like in your schoolyard anywhere, or a dandelion in the crack of a sidewalk. I mean, it's almost by honing in and drawing something, it makes it interesting. And so it's something you can take kids out, do a quick little walk around, bring something back to draw, or have them take their notebook out and actually keep a sketchbook of stuff. I actually do keep my red sketchbook. So I'd like to do one more example before I turn it over to Mary of a way that one of the teachers at Lowell Elementary worked with her kids and seeing how, you know, these observations could be applied to maybe some further art projects. So yeah, if we could pull that up. I love this video that Jennifer James down at Lowell Elementary did. So yeah, if we could pull that one up, Nicole, that'd be great. See there, it's also very fertile ground as it is for doing some collaborations with, you know, maybe language arts teachers, science teachers, all that, and doing a project like that. So Mary, I think I should turn this over to you.
Okay. Well, I love that Lowell School. It's right in the city. It's on the east side, so I always enjoy that. You know, it looks like they're in the middle of a forest, but it's right in the city. And so in mine, I was going to show you the quarter one slide deck, because I usually put a lot of action into learning. And I see Mary and Susie are here, and we're kind of like Janet's groupies because we've taken some classes with her. And now we try and incorporate nature in everything we do. So So usually at Midvale, our school is pretty big. It fluctuates between 420 students to 520. And so there's usually another art teacher. And this is one of the things that we did for quarter one a couple of years ago. It was after one of Janet's classes, and we had an artist, and you can keep going down a little bit. Now we'll just kind of go. We're not going to stop at every little part, but we had an artist named John Miller that we invited. Janet had in her course in the summer. And so I got into Paddle to the Sea. So I love to use action, and I love to have water and things that we draw a lot, but we also do it and we make things. So I just love that action into learning. And we talk about children engagement, and it really is through movement and touching and smelling and seeing and hearing. So we can keep going down a little more to the next one. So we made these water and land forms, and then we did Paddle to the Sea, and I put a United States map up to show how it would travel. And then we painted waterways with John, and then we made tiny little canoes, and then we brought in a giant 17-foot canoe. And then I always have student teachers, and she did land and water forms, and we did paper mache so that they would have this idea that there's this typography of how the water would run. And it was really exciting because they determined where that water was going to go. And then here's a featuring some of our little sweeties. Like, how can you not love, you know, Joseph Honey, right? So, and then we kept moving on, and I try to make all of my lessons connect. And so we were studying Grant Wood. So I burnt a piece of wood, and then we used it as charcoal. And just so that they had an idea that a lot of tools and art are also made from nature, and to find graphite, but you can also make a drawing tool. Mm-hmm. And we did tiny little miniature landscapes from the bird's eye view. Just like Janet said, there's different ways to view things and looking and seeing. And I try to do a lot of the art activities with three dimension. And we did landscape paintings, and it was a side view. And that was usually most art teachers like to do foreground, middle ground, background. And then I'm really into John Stewart Curry, and he was part of my unit this year as the end for Brave Black Leaders because of his famous work that's in the law library, Freeing of the Slaves. And our school works on a lot of social justice and race and equity and diversity. So nature is a pretty great connection because there's diversity in nature and how we build it in community and survival. And after COVID, we could go on a field trip there. So then here we're just doing landscapes that are expressionists. We studied a First Nation artist, George Morrison, in Minneapolis, who uses blocks of wood. And we actually sanded the wood and battered it up like the driftwood that he found along the Michigan, Lake Michigan. So just to get a sense that, you know, when wood hits the shore, it's pretty battered up, and they sanded it and marked it up. We had some rocks in it. It's pretty active because I'm right across from the four-year-olds. And then we assembled it together. We do a lot of collaborative projects. And then it was auctioned off as a fundraiser for the health community, Access Health. And I thought, oh, we'll just get a couple $100, and it sold for $700. I was like, what? So, and then in the background, you can see we studied sandhill cranes. It's just a wonderful way for students to learn through nature. There's a nature connection. And when you live in the city, I think there's an equity part about children to learn through what's right there, you know? And so here's a collaboration. So we can go a little faster through the portraits because this is just showing what we do in one quarter, 10 weeks of work at Midvale School. And then they did portraits, and they always have to do an animal. So I use found materials a lot. So repurpose. to draw your face and draw who you are. It's just about, you know, being proud about who you are. And then we did a lot of nature and art ecosystems, and because of an acorn in a nutshell, we print leaves, we do all kinds of things. And I tape it to that tray, that really helped stabilize it. And then we were featured by the university on this kindergarten unit I did on Fall Is Not Easy. And we made rakes, and we raked, and we made leaves, and we studied the veins. So Janet just got me into this phenology wheel, and I was just like, oh, I'm gonna do the phenology wheel for my children. And we went to the rain garden, we plucked all the plants from there, we made flower presses with just rubber bands. And then I cut out some templates, and then I had them put their press flowers there. And then we ended with this, the log. It's the end of, you think it's the end of the tree's life, but it is just really another beginning. And I just loved how that wrapped it up in the end. And then of course we did bees as part of the homes, animal homes. And this is just one part of our feature where we work together and we work on having a time where they can come and make things as a reward. So, and then unicorn horns and Day of the Dead skulls. And then I make a road map just for fun. And I just love how it just tells me where I'm going. You can travel off the path, but it's quite a great discovery. So that's what I put in there. And there's the end. And then later in our presentation, I have more current events of what we did last summer. All right, Janet, that concludes my section.
Yeah. Do we have questions coming up, or do we want to move on?
Yeah, this is the time that we planned on taking a break for any questions. We don't have any in the chat other than like cool inspiration. Thanks for sharing, but if anyone wants to unmute and ask a question right now would be a good time before we go into the second part.
I had a question. So you're both kind of geared towards being art teachers, and what if you're like a science teacher or a reading teacher, and you could see some of the connections coming in, but if you're like, man, I'm not an artist, how can I facilitate these art projects with my students? And if I'm not an expert in art, how, I guess, what is your take on like, hey, non-art teachers, you can do this too?
My take on it, do you want me to speak to it, Mary?
Yes, please, Jan.
I think my take on it is don't let that stop you. You know, there are how many different how to draw books, how many different, you know, YouTube videos. You've probably got an art teacher down the hall who could, you know, point you to some resources. And you know what? Kids are not expecting you to be the artist. And I think by you going through and demonstrating the process and even maybe demonstrating some frustration with it or how can I make this better, you're modeling, you know, that process with them. So, you know, I think that there's no other subject area that I think we have the level of intimidation that we do with art. It's like, oh geez, I'm not a math teacher, I can't learn algebra. It's like, too bad, you learn it anyway, you know? So you don't have to be a mathematician to do math. You don't have to be a, you know, bona fide professional artist. And for some reason we put it down, you know, in elementary school, and we tell people, hey, that's okay. You know, if you don't have any natural talent, just stop the process. And I think it's great to show the kids the flaws. I show kids my drawings that look terrible, that have mistakes in them. I show them how much I erase. Mm-hmm. I think it's important.
Yeah, I think you just a risk because you really don't run out of ideas. You just really run out of the supplies, you know, like, if you want to learn about a frog and you want to teach its sound, like the green frog in Wisconsin, I'm like, oh, well, what could I do to make that sound? It's just really kind of working backwards. And if you have, you know, I'm right across the way from a 4K teacher, And by between the both of you can come up with something, right? You know, and you're delighted with the outcome. And I think children, to see that problem solving and even talking it through is pretty exciting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. If I could just add, so I teach 4K at Midvale, and so Mary is right across the hall from me. And I wouldn't consider myself an artist, but I'm also not afraid to try, especially after taking Janet's class, Earth Partnership, Art and Education or something like that several years ago. But I always use the resources that I have available to me. And luckily, you know, Mary is so gracious and willing to help me, but I can go to her anytime with like, hey, I'm doing something, you know, on, you know, spring peepers, you know, like what, you know, what could I do? And she'll come up with some idea and just like, you know, kind of send me on my way with it. And it's been so helpful. If I didn't have her as a resource, I don't think I would do as much art. So just, I guess the reminder for all of us is to find people that can help us to make sure that we are, you know, doing art with our kids because they love it and it's so fun.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Thank you.
Yeah, that's great. Any other questions or we'll launch back into part two here if there aren't any other questions from folks right now.
I think we're good to go. Okay. So one of the tools that I found, and I know we were talking about, you know, things that grow in the spring and kind of phenology and all that. And I think some of you are really familiar with them, are these wheels of time and place, the phenology wheel. And I can't say enough about these. What a great, simple tool they are. I did not invent them. I certainly didn't invent the circle, but I've seen them be a really good tool for people of all ages, where you're kind of doing a circular journal of a place or something that you observe or a species. So Nicole, if we could pull up that website, I can kind of walk you through this. So this website, Partners in Place, I think any of you that took, you know, classes that I've done through the Arboretum, the UW Arboretum, Earth Partnerships, or UW Stevens Point, I've used these for years. And what's great about them, why don't we go on to gallery down here, Nicole, on the left. What's great about them is that you can use several ways of going in and recording your observations. And you can go through and look at, you know, different examples on the gallery. But, you know, people use a combination of writing, of drawing. They're great for single spot observations. Like you could pick your spot. Like in your school forest, your nature area, you can do them with like the phenology of one species, like I've done like with the oak tree, where I kind of did the phenology of that. And just a story about these. I was working with a science teacher in sixth grade out in McFarland when I was the school forest person there. And I went in to introduce the activity to the sixth grade classroom, and they were not used to going out and, you know, doing sit spot observations in science class. I mean, the first day, I swear, was like, honestly, it was like letting the monkeys out of the zoo. I mean, they were all they had to do in 45 minutes was pick a spot, and it was barely everything we could get through. And I thought, oh my God, this is going to be a mess. But those science teachers kept taking the kids out just once a month, and they all had their spot, and they had to draw and observe something in their spot. It was about May, and I was out there pulling garlic mustard and just working out there. And all of a sudden, I see kids coming down the hill out of the school. The teacher isn't even like hurting them. They have their clipboards. They've got their wheels on there. They walk over there. They sit in their spot and they were drawing. Not like I'm saying obedience is great, because, well, it is great, you know, sometimes, but just that they really took ownership over it. And it was not getting discouraged by those first or second attempts. that I think was the key to it. And there are good resources on here for, if we go back to that Wheels of Time and Place, there's good resources here on getting started. Here on the left, getting started, observe and record. There's some really good tips of how to approach this and approach this with kids. So these are different types of wheels that you can do. There's a lot of kind of theory behind it to look through, but really it is so, it's so simple. And there's different templates. If you go down here, Nicole, where it says download digital wheels and get started, it's up at the top. Okay, so these are free. So you can download any of these templates. If we click on that, Nicole, it might get big enough that we could see it a little more. No, it didn't. What about Click for Deed? Okay, so here, not only do you have something that you can use throughout the year, but there's also like wheels that are divided into quarters. And you can use that for like a single spot observation where you might be in your spot and you might draw something in one section about what you hear, what you see, what you smell. Yeah, I suppose what you taste. So there's all sorts of different ways that you can adapt these to your situation and what you want to do. There's even a blank one. So you could, you know, adapt that to whatever. And I think, you know, I feel like I'm talking kind of fast here and covering a lot of content, and I'd you know, really like you all to take a few minutes and, you know, go through the site, look at examples. But I think the real value in this, a lot of times when we do sketchbooks or nature journals, they're very sequential. You know, they're like this. Here I'm looking at, you know, page one, but I can't see page 10. I can't see what, here's maybe February. I can't see what was happening in July. So what this does is it gives you like a snapshot of this whole time that you spent observing. And so you can see changes and you can, you know, kind of chronicle what happens to a plant and you, a plant, an animal, whatever you're observing around. And you can do this with anything, any kind of plant you're growing in the garden. Any type of tree that maybe a kid would want to adopt, you know, and, you know, draw, get to know more. You can pull in using other resources to come up with images. So if it, if the tree isn't blooming right then, it can become kind of a research project like, okay, let's pull up a picture. How did those blooms look? How can you draw that like in the spring section of the wheel? Yeah, does anybody have like some questions about those or comments? Because I know it's kind of a lot to throw at you in a short amount of time.
We only have Janet for a few more minutes, and I know most folks are planning to leave at 5. Mary does have some other things we want to get to, but we only have Janet for a few more minutes. So if you have any specific questions for Janet, now's your last chance.
Yeah, I've got another meeting at 5 as well. And I'm reachable by email, you know, and whatever. So if, you know, people do, you know, come up with questions or, you know, anything they'd like after this, I'm happy to help out. But yeah, I should turn it over to Mary because she has another great, fine, real life example.
Well, I think that it was just such a springboard having your class, because I noticed that if you're prompt or if you see kind of a little window, it really helps you move in the direction of incorporating nature. It doesn't seem like when that class in McFarland, it becomes just, it's easier with the frequency and routine. So I was going to have Nicole show the one about the slide deck, that one. That's how I'll end today. So this is one I really love our trees out in the garden. And so when I saw that tree mapping class offered at Stevens Point, I'm like, oh, I have to take it, because we have had, maybe go to the first slide, the outdoor, our school is situated off of Midvale Boulevard, and we had these garden gates made by a metal artist. But we have all these trees that we received from a grant from California, and they're all fruit trees. And then I made horses 1 year. But then I'm like, oh my gosh, we should tree map these things because I think that they're really important. And then we can go to the next slide, Nicole. So then we hired this artist, Erica, to come, and she is a metal artist, and she makes giant trees. And we had her commissioned to make a metal tree for Access Health on Park Street. But to do that, we had to have the students have a connection because it's part of the community that it serves. And so I took this cardboard that they pack all these bulletin boards and the whiteboard we see, and I cut them into squares, and then I had the kids fashion them into tree rings, and they made their own tree ring, and then I stacked them. So that was part of that. And so she's showing the welding apron, and Emily Gritt is the other art teacher many years ago. And we had such a great time. We even took them to the studio, and she had us collect metal things that were magnetic. It's pretty fun. And then at Access Health, they had an artist, Amita Roller, who painted a tree with our older students, third through fifth, and it was all funded by Access Health grant work. And it's really community-based. It's for people who, the biggest donors are people who believe in access for our underserved population. And then of course, our teachers are very invested in the community and in response to George Floyd's death. On State Street, people were painting murals, and another art teacher, Charlotte Cummins, said, I wanna paint a mural, I wanna do something beautiful. And so we called teachers from Midvale and Lincoln and Leopold, and they came, and we ended up painting this mural of, we titled it The Black Princess. If you're on State Street, you'll see it. And it's in the book, Let's Talk About It, by the American Family. So we're very proactive. And with that, we think about equity for our students at Midvale. And when Janet came out to do the drop and, you know, stop and draw, sit in one space, I thought, well, you know, one of the equity pieces is to have nature and to have them connected to nature base, because a lot of times when you go to the boundary water, or if you're camping and you are part of nature projects, you want to have our students have access to that. But what access point could it be? So how about the tree around us? So that's why I thought, well, tree mapping would be a great start. And so when I took that class, I thought, well, you know, trees have diversity, which would be great for our students. And there's benefits of trees that I think our children are not aware of. And there's also lots of research. And one of the articles that I read in Kate's course was that about ADHD, but I was really curious about engagement was higher for students after they had been on a walk or experienced outdoor learning and was out in the garden. So I start to look at classes that were at Midvale and the ones that were doing outdoor education. They just seemed so happy. So I'm thinking, and they were very interested in things. So I thought, well, you know, I think there's a correlation about trees there. So I thought, yeah, we're gonna learn more about trees. So then I thought, well, eco benefits, what do our children do not know about eco benefits? And then thinking about our students operating in deficit mode, well, let's stop the deficit mode. Let's give them something rich and powerful that we all can learn. And so then I thought, wow, okay. So, and then the next slide, there is an old map I found in 1994. And I thought, oh my gosh, these are trees that are probably long gone. So I decided, well, we need to do a real good tree mapping for next year. And then COVID hit. And so we're gonna do it in the fall. So I in our resources that I have available, I did write down the assignment that was a research project from the tree mapping class. But I did write in this slide deck, I put down a tree makes me wonder. And I thought, well, if we paired the DNR mapping tool, that could bring something inside, outside, and outside, inside. And they would need adults to help. But I think I could find enough adults to help me with that. And then I thought, well, it would be just great to have trees as storytellers and that they're living historians of the past and the present. And then I thought, well, you know, we could plant a tree after having some, you know, thoughtful things about what our diversity at our school and how it reflects trees. So that this would be, I would really like to investigate more of that with art and then have some strong science. And then the last slide I have is about the lessons that I plan to teach in the next year. They're just 10 of them, but I highlighted the ones about the superpowers because our students are really into graphic novels and I love to do animation. I did a lot of animation last year. And then I thought, well, how does a tree help me breathe? Because we have a very big mindfulness program here with our wellness teacher. And then I thought, well, gee, I think we could really work on our diversity. And then I love the part about the cycle with the tree, how it has from beginning to end, but it really doesn't end. And I just thought that was just such a great avenue, and it's really inspiring. And I'm kind of looking forward to doing this next year. So yeah, so there's I have it, and I really love Midvale. And I really loved how Janet inspired me to do that. So thanks, Janet.
Oh, thank you. It's great to see the projects, you know, at the end in examples, because usually I'm just kind of the launcher of things, but to see how things, you know, came about and all the ideas that can spring mm-hmm. from mm-hmm. that. Can I say it? Seed?
Yeah.
Okay. Branching out. Stop it. Okay.
Mary, there was a comment in the chat about how neat it would be to do a comparison from that 1994 map to today, you know, because 27 years isn't that long for a tree to live, except in an urban environment that is. And so somebody was wondering how many of those trees are still there. Were you able to make that comparison yet?
No, I think I would love to do that. And I saw that in the chat and I'm like, oh yeah, I'm going to write that down. Because that could be the greatest part of for children to see, you know, the past and the present and the future.
Mm-hmm. Neat. And then if you don't mind, just for a second, I'm going to have Kate explain really briefly what the tree map is, because I think there are folks here who might not be familiar with what that is. So Kate, I'm putting you on call here just for a second to tell us about what the tree map is, if you don't mind.
And I'm going to go because I have another meeting, but thank you all so much for your attention and all that stuff. So, all right.
Thanks for spreading the art love, Janet.
Yeah.
Yeah. Happy to do it. Happy to do it. Thank you all. All right.
Well, I guess the tree map is this online tool where you can, it's like a GPS, GIS based thing, and you can put little dots on the map, and then those little dots represent trees that are in your schoolyard or your community or wherever you're doing the inventory, and you just need to know the tree species and how big it is. So like its diameter. And then it calculates out all sorts of different benefits that those trees are providing to the community. And it's focused on urban, semi-urban areas, not like a forest. And trees provide a lot of different benefits from health and wellness that Mary was talking about, to energy savings, water benefits, carbon storage. There's a bunch of other benefits too that trees are good at doing. And so it quantifies all those different benefits with actual numbers, and you can really start imagining what those trees in your community are doing. And that's just a quick intro, but it's a map that the DNR made available for educators for free in the state of Wisconsin. And so if you're interested more, we do have the course that Mary was talking about, and I think it's a really cool tool.
It is. I can't wait to use it. Yeah.
And Steve just mentioned the class doesn't take a lot of time to learn. We are at 5 o'clock, and I know that some folks are planning to leave at 5. Mary, did you want me to show that last A Tree Makes Me Wonder link? Okay. It's in their resources, so they can look at it if they want.
Thank you.
Last questions or items of discussion or anything else that we want to ask or say to Mary or anybody else for that matter before we all have to go. opening up the floor, and feel free to put your camera on if you do want to ask a question. Is there anything else you were wondering about?
You're welcome.
Thanks coming in through the chat.
Mm-hmm. I really liked the connections you made between diversity of trees and ecosystems, so biodiversity, and how that applies to human system diversity too. How would you say students take that? Because I feel like a lot of people get intimidated by engaging with social and environmental justice issues. And so I'm wondering if you can just kind of reflect on that process and art's role in that a little bit more. Because one of the cool, powerful tools I see about art is that it's a vehicle for self-expression. And so I'm just wondering how you feel working with that in social and environmental justice things.
Yeah, our school has a lot of access to diversity, so we can ask teachers and experts, and then we have professional developments that we develop ourselves. Like this, we had Black Excellence a few months ago, and now our group that are Asian, which is a pretty broad spectrum, are presenting at Asian Excellence, and then they're having a celebration with readers and with literacy. And so I think we're not afraid to learn. We do make mistakes, and we have people that say, hey, you know, can you talk about, you know, First Nations and hockey? And I mean, I think it's really healthy, because sometimes it's awkward because we do make mistakes in how we say things or present things, because our children have a lot of diverse backgrounds. Our Hmong community is very interesting, because when we talk about our children that are blended, they'll say, well, that's doubled instead of half. And I thought there's just some niceties about having access to people who really want to share. It's just, I think we just say, oh, what can we say that would work better? Or how could we say this? Or what do you know? And it's, you just have to be open, and so really being humble about asking for help. But our environment, I like it that we now talk about the land that we're on rather than just gloss it over. We do make that recognition at the beginning of all our presentations. We do acknowledge our different groups of not just holidays, but the merits of the culture that provided, like things in the current events to things that we use every day. It is. It's an exciting place to work.
Thanks.
Yeah, and I thought the point you made about access to nature being an equity issue, that's huge, and it's something I think that in the LEAF program we already take to heart, but are trying to take more seriously and have that be a focus of our next few years, is how can we help make access to nature more equitable for students in the whole state of Wisconsin. So thanks for pointing that out.
I started thinking about that when there was someone wrote a grant to get canoes from the MSCR program and Rutabaga here for middle school, because these two people who had just wanted to put a canoe into the river that was right next to the school, the students were afraid to go in the river, and they decided to, let's tackle that fear on. And then they became experts at it. And now I see the canoes are by Wright School all the time now. So I think it's interesting how one to two people had this idea about, we have nature right here, but we're afraid of it. And I thought it was just such a beautiful, it just unfolded. And now it's become a practice in their curriculum. And I noticed my students never had seen a 17-foot canoe either. And you know, my dog's footprints are in it and everything. And they got to go sit in it. And I think to see that and to have up close is really important, the hands-on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, cool. Any other questions for Mary before we let her go and let everyone go enjoy the rest of their evening? All right. If you do think of anything, you have email access to all of us. You're getting thanks and accolades in the chat. And at any point, feel free to reach out and we can connect you with Mary or Janet. I will send via email the link to the Google Doc or the Google folder to make sure everybody has access to everything. But thank everybody. Thank you all for coming so much. I know it's hard to spend a little more time on Zoom, and it's hard to carve time out of everyone's busy day. So thanks for being here. And Mary, thanks especially for putting your time in and sharing your thoughts and resources. Steve just reminded us, we do have one more tea and tapas coming up in May, and that focuses on invasive species and garlic mustard pesto, which I have never made. So I'm looking forward to that one myself. But sorry, I interrupted you, Mary, but thank you again for being here.
Oh, well, thank you. It was a delight.
All right. Bye-bye, everyone.